Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And we will be getting into episode 5 of Andor in this episode. But first, Jay, can remind everybody where we can be found around the internet.
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our full spoiler discussion of episode 5 of Andor, which is titled The Axe Forgets. So this is the continuation of the story that began last episode, where Andor has been inserted into this rebel cell by Luthen, and they're getting ready to raid the Imperial garrison on Aldhani in the hopes of stealing the payroll for that sector. And then meanwhile, back on Coruscant, we are seeing Mon Mothma as she is dealing with her husband and some family life and some other bigger issues that are going on. And then we get a little bit more about what's going on with Dedra Meero and the ISB. Jay, what did you think about this episode overall?
Oh my gosh, there was so much density. And I know we had talked about that a little bit before we had started recording, that there's a lot to sift through. And, you know, again, it just keeps going with this tradition that I have to say, I keep waiting for the, pardon the pun because this is the episode title, but I keep waiting for the axe to fall. Or I'm waiting for the other shoe to drop, or whatever analogy or phrase that you want to use. And we haven't gotten that yet. So I'm just not used to not having, you know, more action than this. And we got a little bit when Cassian and Luthen were trying to flee. But other than that, we've really not gotten a whole lot. But there's a lot to think about in this episode. And there's some hints of, I think, what is to come. And so I think, you know, patience is going to have to be a virtue with this, but I'm excited to break this down because I always seem to find a lot more to talk about than I think I'm going to. Like when I watched the episode, I thought, I wonder how much we're going to get to talk about, but then we always find something and we end up going off on tangents, which I love. So yeah, so that's my major take, but what about you?
Well, you know, it's interesting because one of the things that I've heard a lot of people say is that they don't come back to Star Wars for the action. They come back for the characters. And if that is true in your perspective, then you got to be loving this series because it is full of gritty characters that are extremely well acted. This may be the best acted piece of Star Wars anything when it comes down to it. And I'm talking about Andor as a whole. Mm-hmm. Not to say that there's been poor acting in anything else, because I think it's been just fine in The Mandalorian and The Book of Boba Fett and Obi-Wan Kenobi and the likes. Even the voice acting and all the animated stuff has been spot on and been great. But there is just something about the quality of the delivery of lines in this one, especially some of the stuff that Diego Luna does in this episode mm-hmm. as Cassian. It's just really, really, really first rate. I like it quite a bit. And here we are on the precipice of what I'm assuming is going to be a very action heavy episode next week. When we actually get into the garrison and they try and steal the payroll, because everything has led to this, and there are some really outstanding scenes in this episode. So with that out of the way, I think we're going to do what we did last time, and as opposed to going through the episode scene by scene, we're going to discuss each one of the different storylines. Right off the way, there was not nearly as many Easter eggs and references in this episode as there was last week. And I guess that's partly because we didn't spend nearly as much time in the gallery that Luthen owns. Mm-hmm. But it was fine. There were still some references, and we'll get to those as we go along. But the episode starts with Syril, so we'll pick up there. He is at his mother's home on Coruscant. She's kind of bullying him a bit about his failures and, you know, making remarks that, you know, you're slouching. And I should have known, you know, is that how you presented yourself to the world? And that's not a very good impression. And, you know, I'm going to consult Uncle Harlow and see, you know, what we can do about your future, because you have no prospects for the future. And then our last scene of Syril is him activating that holo of Cassian and looking at it. So what did you think of Cyril's portion of the episode and his interactions with his mother?
I think he's going to end up becoming unhinged in some way, shape, or form, because he's only going to be able to take so much. I mean, he, as we said last episode, he basically went crawling home to Mama with his tail between his legs. And yeah, she's definitely a bully towards him. And he's just trying to kind of get his life back in order and get things to work. And I have to say, I'm very interested in that Coruscant crunch or whatever he was eating for breakfast
with the blue milk.
Yeah, it was basically like Cocoa Krispies with a little blue in it. But you know, you get this impression that he is stuck in this vicious cycle right now, because you see him eating his cereal and his mom is bickering at him. And then you go back to him and it's the next day and he's eating his cereal again and his mom's bickering at him. So yeah, I'm very interested to know who Uncle Harlow is. And what does he have to bring to the table other than maybe more blue milk? But again, you know, I kind of do feel a little bit bad for the guy in a way. I know he brought a lot of it down on himself, but then again, poor guy was just trying to do what he thought was right. But did you see the Melorun fruit on the table?
Oh, I did miss that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, so she had like a little fruit tray kind of a thing. And I don't know if the other one was Ashura fruit, which is what Anakin cut for Padme in Attack of the Clones. But there was very definitely Melorun fruit sitting there.
Very cool. Well, I didn't get a chance to watch this one as many times as I usually do before I discuss it. But I am definitely will be going back and watching it at least a third. And I'll take a look for that. Yeah, I'm curious about Uncle Harlow as well. One of the things I'm kind of curious about is I'm not sure all the days are matching up in this series, because it feels like more time has passed since the raid on Ferrix for everyone that was in the Preox Morlana corporate security forces than it has for Cassian. Because, you know, we've had an ISB meeting, and then it was Inspector or Lieutenant Blevin has traveled out to Preox Morlana and shut them down. And then he goes to Ferrix and is setting things up there. And Syril has been sent from Preox Morlana back to Coruscant, and he's experienced at least a couple days. And it feels like it's a couple more days than what Cassian has experienced. And maybe we're just not getting all of the same cues about the passage of time with Cassian, with the number of meals and stuff like that. But anyway, and I may just not have this all lined up in my head correctly, but it feels like Cyril's been waiting around a little bit longer than Cassian and Vel's team have been preparing for the raid.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And you almost wonder if there's different sun cycles and things, but I know that there's a galactic standard for time as well, but that's a good point. I didn't think about that.
Yeah. Well, we'll keep an eye on that, and it's not a big deal regardless one way or the other, but it just feels like Cyril's had a lot more time to sit around and think than Cassian's had to be engaged with his group. Anyway,
pry into his cereal.
Yeah, and I guess the other thing is that I'm discounting is, yeah, we spent the last episode, Cassian and Vel took like a day to get back to the camp, and it just didn't look like it was a day when they were doing it.
So she did mention that.
But I mentioned Ferrix and the ISB. Well, actually, one last thing. The other thing is kind of throwing me here is that when Syril went home and his mother answered the door, she smacked him, but then hugged him and brought him in. And now he gave that very curt, like, mother when he got to the door. So we knew that there was some sort of an issue there, but she seemed much more loving and concerned in that brief moment that we saw her in the previous episode than she did here.
Right. Yeah.
She was just nagging constantly in this one, almost delighting in his failure and punishing him for not explicitly inviting her to come visit him. on Morlana. Right. One.
Yeah. And he's like, I had an extra room. You were welcome anytime. And she's like, an implied invitation is no invitation at all. You know, and just making all of these excuses. Yeah.
So, right. Let's head over to what's going on with the ISB. I kind of mentioned it already. We see Blevin setting up operations on Ferrick, and there's a Captain Tego that he's asking if he wants to take over this hotel as like his base of operations. And so that's going to happen. And then later we see him back at ISB headquarters. This guy gets around. He's like all over the place. He was on Coruscant, then Morlana One, then back on Coruscant, then Ferrix, and then back on Coruscant. And while that's going on, Dedra and her assistant are tracking all these various materials that have been or have gone missing from various places that belong to the Empire. So there's proton torpedoes that are missing, and there's the star path that is what set her off in the previous episode. And, you know, she's like, I'm not even sure what it is I'm doing, right, or if this makes sense. And her assistant's like, no, it does make sense. And they're very clearly seeing connections that suggest to them a series of rebel cells, even if no one in the ISB but them gets it.
Yeah, and you could tell that Meero is very, very uncomfortable in her own skin. You know, she was pulling at her collar and, you know, just definitely not what a crisp ISB agent would be all about. You know, you think of them as being the epitome of composure and being able to just do whatever they need to do and very determined and right on top of things. And when you said, you know, she mentioned, I don't even know what it is that I'm doing. I think she's really starting to doubt her place in all of it. And she wants to do so much more than she can, or that she feels that she can.
Yeah. And she also got that dressing down from the superior officer, Adrax Patrak. I can't remember what his name is. It's something like that. In the previous episode, so she thinks she's feeling a little bit gun-shy about everything, but she's trusting her gut. She's trusting her instincts, and at least she's got an assistant that really believes in her, and she's like, she makes that one comment. It's like, oh, I didn't notice the time. You should go home. And he's like, well, I'm staying if you're staying. Uh-huh. And so she really does have some good support in her corner, with at least with her, you know, her staff. And I really am just kind of waiting for, of course, I'm not rooting for the Empire, but at least within the confines of the ISB and the Empire, I'm rooting for her compared to everybody, because I feel like she's been treated so poorly while she's there. And so, you know, the best of the villains, I guess, is the way to think about it.
Right. So what do you think she was popping there at the end of that scene? Were those stim capsules to try to keep her awake while they were doing some more digging into all of this mysterious goings on, or was it like the galaxy's version of ibuprofen, or what do you think?
All good guesses. It could have been any of those things. I think you came away with the right impression there, that she's stressed. Maybe she's got a headache from all this, so she's taking something to deal with the headache, or alternatively, she's got to, you know, give herself a little bit more energy. So that's 5-hour energy in a pill form or something. Right. I don't know, you know? And so I think your instinct on that is correct either way, that she's under a lot of stress. She's under a lot of pressure. And so she's taking something to give herself either a boost or some relief.
Mm-hmm. Or both.
Yeah. Well, then the last storyline before we get back to Cassian is what's going on with Mon Mothma. And I guess, Jay, if I had to summarize it, it's like these are little vignettes that are showing the lack of support she gets at home and how kind of maybe it isn't all Perrin's fault. And by that, I mean, we get this scene where it's the morning time. They're at the table. Breakfast is being served. Perrin comes down. Mon Mothma's been eating her breakfast. And then their daughter, which I didn't even know they had one, Leda, I believe is her name, comes down, and Mon Mothma is intending to take her to school. But Leda says, I'm going with Dad. You're off the hook. And Mon Mothma's like really upset about this and says, you know, we scheduled this. And she's like, no, you're just showing off. You know, you're trying to show that you're involved, but you really aren't. So, you know, this is all for you, and I'm not going with you. And so, you know, Mon Mothma says, well, this hurts and this is hurtful. And she gets up and leaves. What did you think about that interaction?
Well, you talk about the acting being so good. And, you know, as you mentioned, the word vignettes, and same thing with Syril too, is that you feel like this is something relatable. It's mm-hmm. very gritty. It's very homespun in that way. And, you know, whoever would have thought that Star Wars would be exploring the angst of teenage life, you know, in a senator's household kind of a thing. But, you know, I think you're right when you point out that it serves to kind of shed the light on, you know, what's really going on with the support system that she's experiencing as a senator. And gosh, her daughter was really just not having any of it when it came to, you know, her taking her to school. And, but then again, I mean, Perrin just kind of sat back and Mon was basically calling him out and saying, you know, thanks for the support kind of thing.
Right.
So there's a lot of tension, you can tell, going on there. And so what was it about her husband not wanting to say the driver's name? Did he just not know it? Or, you know, what was that all about? Did you catch that?
I think it's intended to kind of paint him as someone who is stuck up on himself and he can't be bothered to learn the names of the people that are serving him, you know. And, you know, yeah. She points out, like, you know his name. And then later, well, like when they're on the way home later, he's like, what's his name again? And, you know, she's like, it's Chloris, you know that. And so it's just kind of it's a contrast where I think Mon really got the short end of the stick from her daughter. You know, she's not just trying to show off. She is interested in her daughter's life, but I'm guessing Mon's not as home as often as she would like and has probably missed a lot of key events in her daughter's life. And so that's what's really going on here. You know, we've all seen it. People get wrapped up in the work and sometimes you miss things. And professional athletes, rock stars, musicians, actors, and high level executives, it's kind of a trope that they aren't going to be around for key moments in their children's lives. And how many different movies have that as their theme, that if they could just get dad to come home for dinner one time, you know, someone makes that wish. And then, you know, and so the parent is then forced to reevaluate their life and stuff like that. And so I think that was what we're supposed to get out of that scene, that she's a busy person and maybe she's a little bit more dedicated to the life of the untold billions, if not trillions, of people in the galaxy, that she's to the extent that she's missing things at home.
Mm-hmm. And you know what, but I appreciate it because the fact that this is kind of, again, in the same sort of vein as Rogue One, in that, and I mentioned earlier, it's relatable. You know, these are real people just living their lives in different parts of the galaxy. And, you know, even though we tend to think of them as rebellion figureheads, they still had lives and they still had mm-hmm. things going on. But who is this Tar or Gar Tafid? Have we ever heard that name before? That there was mentioned that Gar Tafid knew more about what Mon was doing than Perrin did. So what?
Yeah. So you're referring to that reference when they're on their way home from whatever the dinner party type situation was. I looked it up and the only notation in Wikipedia is from this episode that he was mentioned.
Oh,
so
okay.
Seems to be a brand new character. I mean, I was thinking, was this someone like Gar Saxon when I heard that name? But I don't know. Gar Saxon was a Mandalorian and mm-hmm. no reason to think that this person is, or other than a similar name or whatever. But you know, so that gets us into that scene. They're on the way home. They're not sitting close to each other in the back of their limousine, which is our town car that Chloris is driving for them. And so Peril makes this remark about, or Perrin rather, makes this remark that, you know, I was, you know, Gar Tafid knows more about what's going on in your life than I did. And she says something along the lines of, oh, that must be embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
And very passive aggressive going on here. And then he makes that comment, or he questions, when were you going to tell me about the new foundation? And she says, well, I didn't think you'd be interested. And he's like, why is that? And she said, it's charitable. So again, we're getting these, in the two episodes that we've seen Perrin, he's not getting a flattering portrait at all.
Right.
You know, as someone who is more interested in dining with the Imperial cronies in the last episode. And then again, he's kind of stuck up on himself and, you know, he doesn't know the driver's name. And Mon makes this comment that, you know, you wouldn't have been interested in this project because it's got to do with charity. You're not into charity. So he doesn't like that. So he tells the driver to get on the expressway so they can get home quicker.
Right. I thought that was all expressways on Coruscant.
Yeah, I guess there's a lane that you can't just get off as fast. I don't know. So
there you go.
Lots
of learning all kinds of things about everyday life in the galaxy.
That's right. That's right. Any last thoughts on Mon Mothma and Perrin and their daughter?
No, not really. I mean, like I said, I just think it's really interesting to get to see that basically the real life, everyday kind of thing that's going on between her being a senator and working behind the scenes in the early stages of the rebellion.
Yeah. Pairs nicely with what we learned about Padme and her time as a senator as well.
Yes,
but
for sure.
She was off many more blaster wielding adventures as a senator than I think Mon ever was. Okay. So let's get into Cassian's part of the story on Aldhani with Vel and her team. And we first see him, he's waking up in the morning and immediately notices that his stuff is gone, and he rushes out and he finds Skeen outside of their hut, who has basically gone through all of his things because, as Skeen puts it, Vel asked him to, and it all checks out, everything's there. So, you know, I guess they were trying to decide if he had any type of bugs or monitoring equipment on him, and the answer to be no. But then they have a conversation that I don't quite follow. Skeen's got a number of tattoos, and one looks kind of like a barcode with some writing, and I didn't stop it to look and see if it was Arabesh or what, or if it was how it translated. But Skeen notices that Cassian noticed it and says, like, oh, you know what this is. And Cassian says, Cratehead. And he's like, yeah, the rest of them have no idea. And he goes, and you know what this is. And he shows him another tattoo on his arm, and Cassian says, by the hand. I can't find anything that explains that online. So I take it they're supposed to be new things. It's like, you know, that by the hand remark, I was like, well, you know, we've wear the Emperor's hand, but I don't believe that to be the case for Skeen here. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, Krayt, obviously, first thing I think of is Krayt Dragon.
Right.
But the barcode, I mean, the only thing that I can think of is that it, you know, again, it had to be some sort of like a prison tattoo or something. Maybe he was, quote unquote, owned by a corporation, and that was kind of his time card, so to speak, you know, but it's in a weird place. But
well,
then
that makes sense, though, now that you're saying that, because Skeen asks Cassian, and I'm just now putting this together, about where he was and how I'd recognize that. And Cassian says he was at SIPO, which was a youth center. He was there for 3 years when he was 13. And we found out in the last episode that Cassian was on Mimbom at age 16, right after he got released from prison. And he was only there for 6 months before he ran away during the fighting. So I'm guessing those might be prison related tattoos.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's the first thing that I thought of, because he was talking about, like, you know what these are.
Right.
And then the by the hand, it almost looks like I've been watching a lot of Cobra Kai lately, and they use these, I don't even know what they're called, but they almost look like spears. It's the same thing that in The Mummy, when they were the two women were fighting, and it was against each other. I don't know what those things are called. But anyways, so I'm wondering if that's almost like the type of tattoo that someone might get in prison, kind of like the teardrop for killing someone. And so maybe it's kind of something like that to indicate something that happened in prison to him, or that he did in prison. But then there's also a third tattoo kind of on his rib cage that was sort of diamond shape, and they didn't really address that one.
Yeah, well, I think, again, this was to give us some color on both Skeen and Cassian's past. I'm glad we had this conversation, because I didn't put two and two together until we did, about what that would mean and what it likely was. And Cassian's time at SIPO as a youth center at 13 years or for 3 years when he was 13. But you know, the story moves on from there. And Nimic is showing him this old piece of navigation equipment, and you know, Cassian recognizes and says, like, you know, this is like an antique. And Nimic points out, well, right, but it can't be jammed, it can't be intercepted, and while it's complicated to use, you can fix it yourself. And then he makes this comment again on kind of what life is under, like, the Empire right now. It's like, we've all gotten too reliant on Imperial tech, and that's one of the ways they're putting us down. And apparently Nimic is writing some sort of manifesto, and Skeen points that out. Nimic seems like a little bit of a different character than what I was expecting after we met him in the last episode.
Yeah, he's almost actually kind of like a Sheldon in a way from Big Bang Theory, that he's super smart and he's super focused, but he just kind of operates under his own sort of way of thinking. And not that that's a bad thing, because I think that that's really important, especially for what they're trying to do here. You have to really think outside the box. But he seems like a conspiracy theorist as well, you know, with everything, which rightfully so, because they're fighting the Empire, and, you know, everything that the Empire does can be conspiracy theory related. But yeah, he seems super smart, but he's definitely one of those quirky kind of guys, like a Sheldon to me.
Yeah. You're right. He is thinking on a level different than everybody else, because he was making those comments like they hide 40 atrocities behind a single one. And, you know, and he's, you know, he has all these ideas, and, you know, talking about how both his like data pad where he's writing this manifesto was an equivalent piece to this navigation thing, because they both kind of like help show the way to what's going on. And so very deep thinker there. And we can spend more time on him, but there's a lot of other things going on with Cassian, and who's going by Clem, of course, at this point, that I want to get to. So, oh, also another really great line from Nimic before I move on. The pace of repression outpaces our ability to understand it. So, yeah, the Empire is moving so fast that no one really understands how bad the Empire's made everything for them. So,
like there everything's just going by so fast, like flipping pages in a book. And this is where the subtitles really help.
Yeah, that's for certain. We get a lot of instances in this part of the story where Vel and her team are really drilling Cassian on everything that he needs to know. And so, like, Terramin is, you know, giving him like the layout, like when they're just standing out in the fields, like, you know, the bridge is over there and the garrison's right there, and we'll be approaching from that way, and, you know, you got it, yeah, I got it. And then later Vel is quizzing Cassian on where the various weakness of certain things are and where they are going to find certain things. Someone else is kind of quizzing him on Aldhani phrases, because he had that phrase book that he was supposed to learn. And then Terramin is drilling him on like the way that Imperials march. But Cassian also gets a few times, or a few opportunities to shine in all this, where, you know, he says Terramin and Skeen should switch because of one's left-handed and one's right-handed, and you want to have your weapon on the outside as opposed to the inside of their formation. And then Vel picks up that, wow, he made that observation, and quizzes him on the handedness of everyone in the team. Now, a couple of them are handling weapons, so that's an easy thing to say. But, you know, Vel and Senta were not, and he still knew whether they were left or right-handed. And so we're seeing all these little things that make Cassian a valuable asset. You know, his ability to observe and remember that stuff, or the fact that he did observe it when it would just, like, be something that most of us wouldn't even notice, let alone remember, says something quite a bit about him, actually.
Oh, yeah, he's wicked smart, for sure. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was surprising, though, because when they were talking about this Rono hauler and trying to get it up off the track, they were, as you said, they were quizzing him about, what was it, the weight of it? Uh-huh. And they're like, how do you calculate the weight? And at first you think to yourself, well, they're quizzing him because they want to see if he has the right answer. But no, they're quizzing him because they don't know.
Yeah.
And so he was like, wait, you don't know? And then all of a sudden he's like, okay, well, there's this gauge right here, and then there's a lever, and you wouldn't know that because it wasn't, what did he say? It wasn't manufactured that way. It's an add-on.
It's
like an custom job. That's what it is. And it's like, really? And he's like, so how are you going to do this? And Vel's like, we'd figure it out. I don't know about Vel. I understand her position, and she has to be this really hard-nosed leader kind of a thing, but she was really coming down on Cassian as well for things like someone's already sharing that blanket. And then she
I was actually like Skeen was, that did that.
Oh, Skeen, that's right. But yeah. she was very jealous almost of things. And so maybe that's where my brain went, because I'm kind of get the feeling that maybe she and Senta have a relationship.
Yeah, I wasn't sure who Skeen was referring to that Senta had a relationship with, but they can't, you know, it's like Vel was right there, and I wasn't sure if it was Vel or Tiramin, but we'll see how that goes forward. Yeah, Vel is in a very high stress. Everyone in the show is in a high stress position, but she's the one there trying to keep together these other six people that don't like each other and are very suspicious of each other. But it's like Cassian who punches through all this stuff and is like making the decisions or calling the shots that need to be made. Cause like you said, it's like when he realizes like, you all didn't know how to do this, how are you going to get this ship off the ground? And she's like, we would have figured it out. Maybe they would have.
Yeah.
And maybe, you know, maybe Lieutenant Gorn would have been there on that ship and been able to tell him how to do it. But that's why he is critical redundancy, or at least was brought into this, because Luthen knew that they needed somebody like this. And then he's like, no, I'm going to do this because, you know, it's my hide that's on the line. Tell everyone else it was your idea. And, you know, so again, not only does he realize it's critical that he be the one to fly it, he also figures out how Vel can save face with the rest of the group. You know, tell him it was your idea. And then, you know, later, you know, after they're marching to the garrison, and Skeen comes up behind Cassian and tears off the Sky Kyber crystal, and is like, I knew it. I knew that you were lying. You know, this, he's got a rock that's worth 30,000, which was interesting because Skeen thinks it's only worth 30,000. Luthen said, don't accept less than 50,000.
Right,
it's worth a lot more than that to me. So how much is this thing actually worth? Mm-hmm. So that's kind of, I'll be interested to see if that comes up again. But then finally, Cassian, you know, you can see he's really agitated, and he looks around and he says, I'm being paid. And everyone's like in shock, and Vel, you know, Vel's like, I can't believe you said that. You know, we're supposed mm-hmm. to keep it secret. But then Cassian says, yeah, I'm being paid to be here. You need me. And, you know, I can't be going into this with everyone questioning me or not trusting me. I can't remember exactly how he put it. And then, you know, then there's this, Skeen expresses this doubt. He was like, oh, we should have known this a few days ago. And then Cassian's point was, it doesn't matter. If it wasn't this, it would have been something else. And when he gets called out of being afraid, he's like, yeah, I'm afraid, but there's a difference between being afraid and losing your nerve. Don't use me as an excuse not to go through this if you want to get out of it now. And, you know, when we were talking about like the acting at the beginning of this episode, that scene with the way he delivered all those lines was like the best part of the episode for me.
Where, oh, you know, it was so good.
He had all that insight, and then Diego just delivered all these fantastic lines, and it was just, it was so, so well done.
Well, you know, I kind of was really surprised that he tilted his hand that way, but then again, it was the smartest thing that he could have done, because like you said, he didn't want to go in there looking over his shoulder. So, and he knew that he would be if it continued in this way. So yeah, it's such a great scene.
Right. And the other thing that's great about this segment is we get Lieutenant Gorn, and we learn a bit about his backstory over the course of this. You know, he's outside the garrison, and they go up to that temple, and someone's set up a target for target practice. And he's really offended by that. And he's like, you know, why wasn't this cleaned up? And where are the men? Oh, they're helping the commandant's wife move furniture, which you could tell just the look on his face when he heard that. It was like, well, I better get this cleaned up when they get back. And so he leaves them behind. And then he finds Lieutenant Kizmi on there. Okay, before I heard the guy's name, I was like, is that the private that was at Yavin 4 that ran out and told Mon Mothma that there's a battle going on at Scarif? It looked a little bit like him, but I'm pretty sure it was not, because that guy seemed to have a different attitude. But for a second, I was wondering if that, who's that, that was supposed to be.
Oh, that's funny. I didn't even catch that, but yeah. No, I think Gorn does a great job of doing the whole double agent thing.
Right. But then like the most brilliant part of it is they're inside, and he was going on about how he's drawing up the schedule for the next day because they're, you know, the eye, that phenomenon's about to happen. And, you know, it's going to be a reduced schedule so that people can go see it. But then he looks up at that gantry and it's not painted. And he gets really angry about it. And he's like, I've got a, what was it, an Imperial engineer or a Coruscant engineer coming. He's going to be breathing down my neck. And, you know, no one's going to go out and see the eye. You're going to stay here and paint it. And then Kizmi and that other officer is like, oh, y'all do respect, sir. You know, Aldhani is not exactly a great post. And it's really going to hurt morale if more people than necessary have to be here and they're going to miss it. So he basically knew what he was doing. Mm-hmm. He got them all to say that they wanted to leave the garrison. He reduced the numbers inside the garrison and made them think it was their idea.
Yes. Yes.
Brilliant.
That was absolutely brilliant. You're not kidding.
Another one of my favorite scenes from this. But then, yeah, we also learned that one of the reasons that he is in on this is because he fell in love with a local woman, lost a promotion for it, lost the woman. I'm not exactly sure what that means, if she left or she got killed. And then he lost his love of the Empire. And was it Skeen or who? Which one of the characters was like, you know, everyone fights their own rebellion?
Yeah.
Or something like that. Again, another great role. This show, it may not have all the action we want, but it's got a lot of great lines.
Oh, for sure. For sure. And I hope we do get to see the eye. And I'm hoping that's going to be happening in the next episode.
Well, this is kind of like Chekhov's Rancor from the Book of Boba Fett. You know, you put the Rancor in there and you mentioned him a whole bunch of times early. You have to show us Boba Fett riding a Rancor later. Yeah. This eye has been vividly described to us and everyone wants to see it. You know, the audience wants to see it. If they don't show it to us, they've ripped us off.
This is true. This is true. They better put it on the schedule. I noticed that a lot. It's schedule. Because my husband was like, it's schedule. I'm like, that's just how they pronounce it in the galaxy. Come on now.
Because everyone in Star Wars is British. You know
exactly,
this.
Exactly. For sure. And that's okay. Yeah.
Yeah. What did you think about Skeen's, not apology to Cassian, where he was telling him about his brother?
Okay. This was actually really heartfelt, I thought. Mm-hmm. You know, it was something that I think he was desperately wanting to share with Cassian in some ways, just to get him to understand what he was going through. And it was, you know, his brother had lost his farm. Like it was taken away from him by the Empire. And so he said his brother filled his pockets with rocks and then just mm-hmm. went and drowned himself. And I was like, oh my gosh, that is so tragic. And, you know, in so many different ways. So Skeen really, I think he was reaching out to Cassian in that way, almost in, not really in desperation, but just to say, kind of in a validation kind of a way, this is what this means to me. This is how much this means to me. We cannot fail at this.
Yeah, because he says Vel wanted me to tell you, and this is the closest to an apology you're going to get, to which Cassian responds, yeah, like, it's close enough. And, you know, you can understand why it's offensive to someone like Skeen that they have a paid mercenary on the team when you've got Nimic, who has got this manifesto and is very philosophical about the rebellion and why they have to stand up to the Empire. And for someone like Skeen, it's pure revenge, you know, for Gorn. You know, they took his wife, and it's also a revenge matter there. So having somebody who's in it only for the money could be offensive to them.
Right.
But, you know, you got Skeen, who's like putting that behind him because he really wants to get this. He really wants to stick it to the Empire, and mm-hmm. he needs Cassian to do it. So he's explaining where he's coming from, his motives and why it's important to him and why he is so suspicious. You know, that makes more sense when you find it out that way.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Every time I hear the word manifesto, I just think of Tarkin. We need a statement, not a manifesto.
A manifesto. Very good. Yeah, that's a good point. So, all right. Well, this episode ends with we get a scene with Luthen in his galaxy, Luthen in his gallery, and he's listening for broadcast, desperate to find out some hints of what's going on in Aldhani. And, you know, Clea comes in, is basically said, you're not going to hear anything tonight. And we know they're prepared for some blowback to fall on them, or potentially fall back on them, because he asks her about her walkaway pack. And so, you know, there's nothing more they can do. And she's got, you know, she's got this attitude. Like, there's nothing more we can do tonight. It's going to happen tomorrow night, or it's not. And he says, daring prediction. You've got there like that. So, you know, he's antsy. He's nervous about what's going on. And then, you know, they're in place to pull off the raid for the next on the next day. So that's mm-hmm. where the episode ends. Any observations about Luthen or anything else that's going on in this episode we haven't covered already?
Well, just a few little, I guess you could call them just little snippets of things. There is one scene where the TIE fighter comes down and just kind of like zooms right over top. And, you know, it's little things like that. The visuals, I just think, are so perfectly placed. And you truly believe that there was actually just a TIE fighter that just flew right overhead. And so it's just so in universe and it's so perfect in that way mm-hmm. that I just love that. And then, yeah, with Luthen, with the listening of this, I dig him. And again, I want to find out so much more about him. And then we didn't really address the whole reason why this was called the Axe Forgets, because yes. they were talking yeah. about chopping down the tree, and, you know, the tree remembers, but the axe forgets. So now it's our turn to do the chopping. I love that.
Yeah. And that's actually an African proverb, awesome. Which I didn't know that was a real world thing until I looked it up, because I was wondering if there was something out there about that. But yeah, I like, you know, the Empire, this goes back to what Cassian was saying about that. You know, they're so satisfied, they're fat and lazy, that it never occurs to them that someone like me could walk in their house, spit in their food, steal their things. And you know, they've just trampled all over people, and the Empire moves on. Whereas the people that are left behind, they remember. And that's why there's an uprising. That's why there's a rebellion, because the Empire is just too blind to their own success to realize what they, to remember what they did in order to get there. So I thought that was a really, really great line in this episode as well.
For sure.
All right, then. Well, that brings us to the end of our discussion of episode 5 of Andor, The Axe Forgets. I'd like to thank you all for listening. We sincerely hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcaster of choice. And you can like to remind you, you can also find all episodes of the podcast over on richesapp.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything in the pop culture from the MCU, DC, Dune, and to a lot of other fan favorite shows. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you're using, especially if that's Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes over on social media as well. Speaking of which, Jay, can remind everybody where they can find all of our different social media outlets.
You got it, Dennis. We are easily found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. You don't have to tune into weird chatter to try to find us either. Very easy to do. And we also have Pinterest boards and a YouTube channel, which does have all of our past episodes as well as our unboxing videos. So you have to head over there, like, and subscribe. And we do have a Discord room on the Retros App Discord server, where we are just one of many different rooms. All the Retros App shows have their own rooms over there. And there's some really fun dedicated rooms as well. So if you want to join in, just go to our show page, click the community tab, and you are there. And if you are in need of any new coffee mugs, stickers, tote bags, wall hangings, even baby onesies, you can head over to TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And we have 7 different show logo designs to pick from. So there's literally something for everyone.
All right. Before we wrap it up, you want to bring everyone up to date on what you got going on with cosplay?
Oh, sure. So over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, you can catch me mainly right now finishing up my 4th Sister cosplay. Going to be debuting that very soon on October 16th. And the day before that, I'm actually appearing for a grand opening at Operation Fandom Medina. And we'll also be joined by Daniel Logan on that day. And I will be Ahsoka. And so if anyone is in the area, you can pop in and say hi to Daniel and to me and have a great time.
All right. That'll do it for episode 476 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.